Okay, let's talk transport layer. We've already talked a little bit about ports in the other video, but we'll talk just kind of an overview of what the transport layer is and what the transport layer does right now. And just as a reminder, when we're talking about the transport layer, really what we're talking about is how the application layer protocols, like HTTP in this example, communicate with each other across these devices. So remember, the transport layer is the connector between an IP address, a device, and an application running on that device. And it does that through those ports. So the transport layer has a few different functionalities, a few different roles, really, when we're talking about network communication. The first role that we'll talk about here is segmenting, splitting things up. The next one that we'll talk about is sessions. The transport layer handles these connections between devices or between these applications. And then last of all, ports, remember, is the addresses at the transport layer. So segmenting. What is segmenting? Put simply, it is chopping things up and putting things back together. And on the sending end, you have a large message, a video, a movie, a large email, a large document, any large file or large message that needs to be chopped up into pieces to send it across the network, because the network can't handle super large pieces. Specifically, the last point there, segment size is determined by the data link layer protocol. So the data link layer protocol, typically something like Ethernet, has a maximum size of a frame, and that's the maximum size of the data that Ethernet can carry. And every data link layer protocol has its own maximum size. But what it comes down to is that determines how large these segments at the transport layer are allowed to be. Now, they might be significantly smaller than that, but that's the maximum size that these segments can be. So your transport layer protocol is going to take the data from the application, whether it's a file or a movie or an email or a video stream, and it's going to chop that up into pieces to send across the network. Goes down through the layers, gets sent across the network, goes back up through the layers, where on the receiving end, it's put all back together. And that size, the segment size, is actually shared as part of the TCP handshake, or the initial connection in TCP. Obviously, UDP isn't going to share that. It's just going to send data of a certain size. Now, segmenting looks a lot like this. It takes one large image and it splits it up into a bunch of smaller pieces of an image. And then on the receiving end, it's put back together. And if you have a protocol like the Transmission Control Protocol, TCP, that has sequence numbers, then when those things are put back together, they're put back together in the right order. Because what can happen on the network, one packet may get lost, or a packet may take a different route and arrive sooner or later than other packets. So it's important in a reliable protocol like TCP to have a number, a sequence number, to indicate how to put this back together, how many packets need to be sent. It's going to say there's going to be 16 packets. Here they come. And then when they arrive, this is one of two, one of 16, two of 16, three of 16, so that they can all be put back together. And if number four of 16 gets lost, then the receiving computer can say, "Hey, I never got four of 16. Can you send me that again?" And the sending computer can send number four of 16 back across the network again, so that on the receiving end, this receiving device has all of the pieces it needs to put it back together to then hand it back to the application. If you don't have sequence numbers, you can get something like this. So if there are no sequence numbers, things may arrive out of order, or certain packets may get lost. And when certain packets get lost, they're just not a part of the data that the application receives at the other end. So you probably wouldn't want to use something like UDP to transmit an image across a network, because if a packet gets lost, then you're going to have, actually, rather than having an image that looks all messy like this, what you would probably have is a corrupted file that won't open. And that's no good for anybody. So UDP doesn't have sequence numbers, not great for transferring large files across the network. And we'll talk in another video more about kind of why that is. So why or when would you not want sequence numbers? Because they sound pretty great, right? It sounds pretty awesome to be able to put a file back together in the way it was. So there's a few different reasons not to have or want sequence numbers. For one, when old information is no longer needed, you don't want sequence numbers. So when every transmission it replaces the last one. So if you have, for example, a sensor that's transmitting information, super simple sensor, it's transmitting temperature information. And it's transmitting temperature information 10 times a second. So on the receiving end, you want just the latest temperature, right? And if one of these temperature reports gets lost, that's okay. We'll just use the next one. So we wouldn't want sequence numbers to tell us how many temperature reports we need to receive. We'll just use the latest temperature report that we receive from the sensor. Another option for not using sequence numbers is when the delay to retransmit isn't worth the effort. So for example, in a video game or in a video conference, if a packet gets lost, you don't want to stop the transmission and stop the video conference while you wait for that packet to be retransmitted. What you would do instead is move along to the next packet. Just like I talked about with the temperature sensor, you would just move along to the next thing and show the next frame of the video. If you lose a frame of the video, it's no big deal. If you lose a part of a frame of the video, you just don't show that frame, move on to the next one, and you wouldn't want to wait for the sending computer to have to receive the message that the packet didn't arrive and then retransmit again, and then you get it and then people move on. Really, in TCP, reliability is handled by the transport layer. The transport layer makes sure that every bit, every packet gets there the way it should. In UDP, reliability is instead going to be handled by the application, or it's going to be handled by people. For example, in a video conference, if you lose 3 seconds of video in a video conference, the person can stop and say, hey, we're losing you. Can you repeat what you just said? And that is where we handle reliability. Rather than stopping the video conference, waiting for every single packet to arrive before playing that video conference forward, because that just makes for an awkward and weird interaction. And the last reason not to use sequence numbers is when you don't need every single bit. And that kind of ties into the other ones that we talked about. So connection-oriented versus connectionless protocols. If you think, when you think about a connection-oriented protocol, I want you to think about a phone conversation. So there's, to set up a phone call, you dial the number, you say who you want to talk to by dialing a number, and then the phone rings. And think about that phone ringing as initializing the first step of initializing the conversation. And then on the receiving end, they pick up the phone, they say hello, and that's the second step of initializing the conversation. And then the person who calls says hello, and we've got a conversation going, and then we can talk. But basically every phone call starts the same way. Phone rings, pick up the phone, say hello back, and then we're talking. And then at the end of the conversation, you both say goodbye to end it, unless you're in a movie and then you just hang up. But in a real phone conversation, you say goodbye. And if you're TCP, it's 4 messages, 2 messages each way to close the connection. That's a lot like how I end phone calls, where it's the goodbye. See ya. Love you. Bye. Okay. Bye. And that's ending a conversation. So that is a connection-oriented protocol, and that's TCP. And we'll talk more about exactly how connections are created in TCP in the next video. The other option is a connectionless protocol, and this is sending a letter. When you send a letter, you don't get any immediate feedback. You don't know if it arrived. You don't know if it even got to its destination. You don't know if the person at the destination received it. You don't know if the person at the destination even wanted it, what they did with it, if they picked it up, if they threw it out, if the mail carrier lost it, if the mail carrier took it and read it himself. You don't know any of that. And that's UDP. That's a connectionless protocol. And like I said, reliability in a protocol that doesn't have sequence numbers or connections is handled at the application layer. So how do you know if a letter received or was received? You know when you get a letter back. And you may never know if you never get a letter back or if you never get any other communication, you never know if that message was received. And that's how letters or that's how letters work, and that's how a connectionless protocol like UDP works as well. And finally, ports. We talked about ports already. Go watch the ports video again. Remind yourself what they're all about. Those are the connection sockets between applications. And that is an overview of the transport layer. That's what things look like at that layer.